Good morning, Nigeria. Good morning, Abuja. Welcome to Daybreak Extra on Trust TV. Coming to you live, of course, from our studio here in the nation's capital. Now, it is a beautiful Saturday morning, as I would say it's the Saturday that it should be. You know, a typical Saturday should be like this. We woke up to a rainy Saturday. Started, I think, early hours of the morning. Until now, it's still drizzling outside. So, yes, I know that for people that know how to enjoy the weekend, they're going to take advantage of this and sleep in, which is something, of course, that we all need sometimes to just rest. And the weather is just favorable for that. So, yeah, it's really a very beautiful morning, I must say. Of course, we do have interesting lineup for you today. Of course, we'll be bringing you a personal trainer who would come and tell us more about the healthy life, you know, how to keep fit and all that. And if time permits, we'll be bringing you entertainment gossips or what's happening. There's been a lot of gossip happening in the entertainment industry right now that we just need to dive in. But if time permits, thank you so much for joining us. I am Sumaya Abubakar. Do not go anywhere. When we come back, we'll dive into what the newspaper is saying. Stay with us.
situation where you find that they must look like the same.
Not necessarily tribal or regional.
But I have said that.
Welcome back to Daybreak Extra on Trust TV. And right now we'll be looking at what the newspapers are saying today. And as usual, we'll start with the Daily Trust newspaper on Saturday. The headline there, the major story says, Tinubu suspends Emefiele. And the writers are saying CBN governor in SSS custody to explain role in Naira swap and others. Suspension long foretold, says Professor Waliki. Shonubi takes charge at Apex Bank. Now, all the stories you'd find on page 5 of the newspaper there. Below the mast there, it says, I'm used to negative things Nigeria says about my husband. Now, this was said by Mariam Abacha. You find this story on page 4 or 7 of the newspaper there. Over 40 vehicles recovered from Matawali, says Zamfara government. You find this story on page 5 of the newspaper. I beg your pardon, page 4. And Baba Aisha, Nigerian's herbal doctor, cashing out on deadly concoction. This story you'd find, interesting story there. You'd find it on page 21, 22 and 23. Below the major story there, it says, demolition, I could have slapped Kwankwaso at Aso Rock. Interesting. This was said by Ganduje. He said that he sold properties to himself, family members. Now, this is an accusation by Kwankwaso, which has actually provoked Ganduje. Okay, there's a drama in Kano State. Now, all these stories you'd find on page 4. In the Daily Trust newspaper. Now, these are some of the stories from the Daily Trust today. So we'll move to the Punch newspaper. From below the marks there, it says 40 vehicles are recovered from Matawale's residence, says the police. You find this story on page 10 of the newspaper. Beside that, you see speakership, Wasi, Betari, and other aggrieved aspirants to adopt candidates. You find this story on page 4 of the newspaper. The headline there, the major story, says experts hail Tinubu as president suspends Emefiele and other CBN probe. The writers there says suspended CBN governor's policies worsen economy. According to analysts, security agents may arrest ex-CBN governor, mount surveillance at airports and others. Now, all these stories you'll find on page 4 and 9 of the newspaper. It says, losing brother, mom in one day, still a nightmare. Late Copper's family, a really sad story there. I am shocked flood swept my husband away despite his hefty stature, says this was according to the wife. You find the story on page 28 of the newspaper. Traditionalists who tamper with my corpse will join me, says Ogun Monarch. This you find on page 29 of the newspaper. Looking good for has favored me. This was said by Ash Moshi. I think the Instagram influencer there. You find this on page 16 of the newspaper. And at the bottom there, it says, El Rufai's comments on Muslim domination against Nigeria's unity. Ex-CAN director says this. You find this story on page 2 of the newspaper. Now, these are some of the stories from The Punch today. So we'll move on to the Guardian newspaper. Below the mast there says, siren abuse, motorists disregard for signals during emergencies and way forward. And I agree with that. You know, situations where you see ambulance moving forward and you know it could mean an emergency, but then motorists don't really care. The entertainment segment says, Susan Puajog, I always love playing character outside my comfort zone. A challenge out there. Toyosi et Etim Efyong until women unravel their identity purpose. There will be no lasting fulfillment. Now, this was said, of course, by Toyosi. The lead story there says NAS leadership tussle, tension in APC over secret ballot rule. And just beside that is a pictorial of the chairman of the APC, Abdullah Ademu. Now, there's a pictorial of the president and vice president meeting with some of the, I think, emirs of some certain places. So we have CBN Governor Emefiele suspended. Tinubu assents to electricity bill. OK states individual to generate power. It's a great move there. At the bottom, we have, I would have slapped Kwankwaso if I met him at Villa, says Ganduje. You find this on page 3 of the newspaper. And NLC TUC asks court to set aside order stopping strike. This you find also on page 3 of the newspaper. Now, these are some of the stories from the Guardian newspaper today. And we'll move to the Nation newspaper this Saturday. From the top there, it says, subsidy, Nigeria no more Father Christmas to other countries, says Tinubu. Okay. The writer there says, payments were bringing the country to her knees. Indeed, you find this on page 7 of the newspaper. Beside there, you see presidential election well conducted. Atiku's witnesses tell tribunal. Tinubu, Shetima APC's objections stole video evidence by OB and Labour Party. You find this story on page 3 of the newspaper. The lead story in the Nation says why Tinubu suspended Emefiele as CBN governor. Apex Bank chief faces DSS probe over alleged money laundering, terror financing, and others. Fola Shodun, Shonubi to act as the central bank helmsman. Now, this story you'll find on page 4 of the newspaper. Ganduje, Kwankwaso renew rivalry over Kano demolitions. Writers there says, I could have slapped him if I had met him in Aso Rock. Ex-governor threatens. Ganduje is the number one stooge, NNPP leader alleges. You find this story on page 6 of the newspaper. Beside the pictorial of the president and Ganduje, we have, and Gbajabi Amila, of course, we have police recover 40 vehicles in raid on ex-governor's Matawale's house. You find this on page 29 at the bottom of the newspaper there. It says, 10th NAS, tell aspirants to manage their ambitions. Tinubu urges traditional rulers. Now, you find this story on page 5 of the newspaper. Now, these are some of the stories from the Nations today. We'll move to the Tribune. From the top there, it says, Southwest PDP reps elect demand House Minority Leader post. Right party leaders Atiku, Makinde, and Adeleke. You find this story on page 3 of the newspaper. Beside there, you'll see vigilante shoots man dead for speaking to his girlfriend. You find this story on page 3 of the newspaper. The major story says Tinubu probes Emefiele, places him on suspension. You find this on page 3 of the newspaper. There's a pictorial of Shay Makinde where it says subsidy removal. Makinde orders release of more bosses, rolls out other palliatives. Flag off 8.3-kilometer road named after Wike. You find this on page 8 of the newspaper. Beside that, you'd see El Rufai's claim of Muslim domination is toxic and frightening. Khan's ex-official and evangelist Kwanku said this. You find this on page 17 of the newspaper. Fuel price hike, we may increase school fees, says private school owners. You find this on page 4 of the newspaper. Priorities, competence, ensure ethnic religious balance in appointments, Olobon tells Tinubu. You find this on page 3. I stopped taking soft drinks 20 years ago, 90-year-old Sonaike said. Now, this story you find on page 16 of the newspaper. He's living the healthy life there. Former governors, 34, others float private universities. You find this on page 5. Of the newspaper. And it says, Senate presidency tussle, votes may sell for $5,000 to $10,000. Interesting throw of money there. And anxiety in Akpabio's camp over Yari. Tinubu seeks royal father's intervention. You find all the stories on page 3 and 4 of the newspaper. Now, these are some of the stories from the Tribune today. We move to This Day, a newspaper there. From the top there, it says, Emefiele suspended and Shonubi appointed acting CBN governor. Emefiele come at home reviewing hand over notes. KPMG, federal government's targets of 6% annual GDP growth, not feasible. You find the story on page 5 of the newspaper there. Below the mask, it says Polaris Bank appoints 2 new executive director. You find this on page 5 also of the newspaper. NLC, TUC asks courts to vacate order stopping the strike. Claim federal government suppressed material facts and misled judge. All the story continues on page 5 of the newspaper. The major story there says, Tinubu, we can't continue as Father Christmas to other countries with subsidized petrol. Insist subsidy was removed so that Nigeria won't collapse and use traditional rulers to actualize your plans, Sultan Oni, Arch President. And there's a picture of the president of and the Oni and Sultan, of course, having this meeting. Now, these are some of the stories. Okay, we have one that says police raid ex-Governor Matawalle's residence and recovers vehicle. All the stories you'd find and more on This Day newspaper. Now, let's move to the Vanguard newspaper today. From the top there, it says, Ganduje in Aso Rock. I would have slapped him. That's Kwankwaso. Slapped Kwankwaso if I had met him. Your atrocity is shocking. Kwankwaso fires back. Now, the first story you'll find on page 12 and Kwankwaso's reply you'll find on page 5 of the newspaper. Below the mask there, it says, Lagos anti-ethnic laws, more knocks on Speaker Mudashiru Obasa. You find this on page 8. Tinubu, Atiku, Okowa, Rubadu, Ibori, the controversies, the truth. You'll find this on page 14 of the newspaper. Insecurity, 325 killed, 150 kidnapped in 10 days under Tinubu. It's really scary. You'll find this on page 12 of the newspaper. Below that, you see Tinubu suspends CBN Governor Emefiele. You find it on page 5. The lead story there says, to crush oil thieves, you must step on toes. Niger Delta stakeholders tells Tinubu. And the writers there says, Army, Navy, Air Force, Police, DSS, I beg your pardon, DSS, NNPC, IOC, top politicians in Villa involved, and governments should probe military in Niger Delta. There, junior officers shamelessly share money with commandants. You'll find this story on page 10 of the newspaper. The entertainment segment shows Iniedo on the rebound. You find this on page 22. And Burna Boy continues global stage onslaught performance at Champions League final tonight. You find this on page 20 of the newspaper. And these are some of the stories from the Vanguard newspaper today. All right, let's move to the Independent newspaper. From the top there, it says, allow traditional rulers to fight insecurity. Oni begs the Tinubu. Beside that, you'd see much ado about Tambuwal's second sojourn to National Assembly. You'll find this on page 23 of the newspaper, of Independent newspaper. Tinubu already implementing what he promised at campaigns. This was said by Oba Elegushi. You find this on page 5. The major story there says, we are not surprised at Emefiele's suspension. According to analysts, say removal is political and ill-advised. Now, this you find on page 4 of the newspaper. And, of course, there's Ganduje and Kwankwaso there. The pictorial shows where Ganduje and Kwankwaso renew battle over demolition as Tinubu intervenes. Says, I would have slapped Kwankwaso if I had met him. I installed Ganduje as governor. This was said by Kwankwaso. You find this on page 19 of the newspaper. Below there, you'd see fuel subsidy palaver. Government must tell Nigerians the truth, says economist and activist. Subsidy obstacle to development, says Kabir Akinbolu. You find these stories on page 8 of the newspaper. At the bottom there, it says, while I will continue to visit Aso Rock. This is said by Mark Inde. You find it on page 7 in the entertainment segment. Akin Lewis, 5 decades of stardom. Now, that's the actor. You find this on page 9 of the newspaper. Now, these are some of the stories from the Independent this Saturday. And we'll move to the Sun. From, you know, beside the marks there, it shows Tinubu, Nigeria no longer Father Christmas to neighboring countries, and says meets traditional rulers in Abuja. You find this story on page 27 of the newspaper. The major story says NAS leadership, APC's consensus proposals suffers fresh setback. PDP, LP, NNPP, Northern lawmakers elect align against ruling party. You find this story, of course, on page 24 of the newspaper. There is international community frowns at plan to intimidate senators elect with security agents. You find this on page 28 of the newspaper. Tinubu suspends Emefiele, orders probe of CBN. This you find on page 25, seems to be the major headline in all the newspapers. We have Ohanaeze appoints Anyaoku, Ugwanyi, 66 others into advisory council. You find this on page 24 of the newspaper. Ganduje, I would have slapped Kwankwaso if. You also find that on page 27. And there's a pictorial of the president and the governor of Enugu, Dr. Peter Mba, on economic mission, which we're hoping will be fruitful. There's leadership, of course. We still have the leadership of the 10th National Assembly. So these are some of the stories that you find in the Sun newspaper today. Now we'll move to the Punch Sports Extra. From the top there, it says, I want to spend a day with Ronaldo. Ungwane said, that's from the celebrity Canada. It's always hilarious over there. Beside that, we have overlooked again, Pesiero snobs Akpom, Boniface for Sierra Leone clash. You find this on page 8 of the newspaper. UCL final, Man City versus Inter, Citizens chase first historic treble, and Haaland eyes Van Nistelrooy record. You find this on page 2 of the newspaper. Osimhen, 5th in Europe's golden boot race. This story you'll find on page 3 of the newspaper. And Falcons move up to 40 in FIFA rankings. You find this on page 8 of the newspaper. The leads there says NPFL Super 6 gone down. Rivers United and Benin Arsenal 21 games unbeaten run. Eguma side Eyimba pick continental tickets. Now, all the stories you find on page 7 of the newspaper. Ighalo in, Ronaldo out. Nigerian star makes Saudi best 8. You find this story on page 8 of the newspaper. Chukwueze distances self from Madrid link. You find this on page 8 of the newspaper. Los Blancos offer £68 million for Kane. You'll find this on page 4 of the newspaper. And lastly, we have Maguire refuses to leave Old Trafford and Newcastle hold talks with Kim. All the stories you find on page 4. Now, these are some of the stories from the Punch Sports Extra. And with that, of course, we wrap up bringing you what the dailies are saying today. But don't go nowhere. We'll take a short break. And when we come back, we get to analyze some of these stories. Stay with us.
where you find that they must look like the same.
Not necessarily tribal or regionality.
Welcome back to Daybreak Extra. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, I'm joined by Aisha Salu. Yes. Good morning, Aisha.
Morning, Sumeya.
What happened?
It's a wet morning. It's been raining cats and dogs all day, all morning. I thought it was going to stop, and getting the ride here was really horrible.
I can't imagine.
I didn't mean to leave you hanging right there.
It's okay. You're looking all greenish. You're representing representing nature. So, yeah. Of course, I forgive you for that.
Okay, no problem.
All right. So, what's happening? What is trending in all the dailies right now, national dailies, is Tinubu suspends Emefiele. And this news broke, you know, late at night.
Exactly. As a matter of fact, I don't think it's coming as a shock. I would like to say that because before now, okay, if we're looking at the reasons behind the whole Naira redesign policy and everything, one would say when, okay, let's say reports have it that when this new administration come in, there's going to be more like a witch hunt. And it looks like that is what is happening.
Yes,
it looks like
so. There's a quote of analysts, you know, saying that it looks like, yes, everyone was expecting it. Because it felt as though it was against, you know, some of the people during the because the policy just went on for, and Nigerians were angry that we suffered for nothing.
As much as lots of analysts are in support of this, there are others who are also saying, like yesterday when the news broke about his
suspension
and also alleged arrest, we're not sure. But then Reno Mokri did say something, you know, he and his nuggets, he always comes out with this words of wisdom, according to him. He did say that one would expect that the Tinubu administration would be an administration of forgiveness. This is like punishment for Emefiele's sins. One would just expect that, okay, he lets him do his tenure and finish up instead of suspending. But then, I don't know what you think. Do you think it's witch hunt, punishment?
No. Honestly, if we, people already, let's be honest, the people that you know, voted the president already have faith in him. And the people that don't are still in doubt. And what he needs to do to prove to them is to show that whoever you are, I'm going to come for you. And if you have any, if you have done any, you know, thing that would hurt the country, it's all about the country. He mentioned in his speech that it's Nigeria first.
I don't really
see it as a hunt. For me, I see it as him just, you know, going, probing the people that hold position and checking them. And, you know, it's all about accountability.
Yeah,
and we've seen how far he has gone, you know, going to different organizations, sitting down, having
a couple of meetings
with
people,
them. That's
National Assembly members, governors.
So it seems as though it's all about accountability.
But then again, don't you think during the Buhari administration, which appointed Emefiele as a CBN governor, all of these allegations leveled against them. Now we're hearing he has to explain his role in the Naira swap, others amongst the full implementation of the Conless table as approved by the National Salaries, Income and Wages. You know, there are lots of many issues. I'm seeing some reports has it that funding of unknown gunmen, that's the Eastern Security
that's
Network
deep.
And IPOP, you know, they're saying he has hands in terrorism funding in the
Southeast. That's a huge allegation.
Do you understand? So, and then there's also mismanagement of Nigeria's social investment program and the anchor borrower scheme. Speaking of the anchor borrower scheme by the CBN governor, I also had an interface with some farmers during the week, just this past week. And then they did say that the anchor borrowers program, which was meant to help small-scale farmers, 2 years after, it's as if the program is just there. It's not reaching the people the program is meant to reach. So that is also questionable. And then there is also illegal economic crimes of national security dimension, money laundering, amongst other allegations leveled against him. My question now is, you did say Tinubu is working in line with the nation, Nigeria. But then didn't the Buhari administration see all of this with Emefiele?
That is a problem. You know, there's been a lot of this like a division where some people feel Buhari is more of a, I trust you, so I delegate you to do this,
and whatever I have complete faith
I have complete faith. So there is no accountability. So he wouldn't really, perhaps he just shun things. He'd be like, okay, I have other things, I've delegated this, so this is mine, let me focus on
you
this.
You know what has been my major concern with this whole the All Progressive Congress administration from Buhari to Tinubu now? One would say whilst Emefiele was doing whatever he was with doing with the Naira redesign policy, he had the backing of the federal government, I mean the former President Buhari, right? And then this is all under the All Progressives Congress.
Indeed.
And now we have, then people would say the APC was fighting the APC,
yeah,
because
it was
the
like
APC took APC to court and all that regarding there lots of governors who were against the Naira redesign policy. True. And now the new president is here, and the first person he's fighting is the CBN governor. That is why some people are saying it's a case of a witch hunt and punishment.
Indeed, a really confusing one there, honestly. And to think that I don't think he even saw it coming. One minute you were occupying this position, the next minute they're telling you, okay, hand over to your deputy.
I was speaking to someone yesterday, and then the person said he wasn't smart enough. He should have seen this coming.
He should have
seen this coming, because he there was no way he was going to go scot-free.
Aisha, the moment they give you CBN governor, just know that at the end of your tenor, you will be probed.
Do you get?
There are major offices that you should know. Nobody should even tell you. So he should have been prepared for
this. So the person was saying he should have perhaps taken maybe a sick leave, traveled abroad, and then from abroad he should have just turned out his resignation. And I'm like, okay, this is way too deep. But then I think that would have been way better than a suspension. Because this is a stain on his name and also his political career, however he may choose to pursue it in the future.
A really sad one there. Okay, it says that to explain role in Naira swaps and all that. You know, while it was happening, people were saying that from the Buhari's camp, someone was coming out to say Emefiele didn't really explain to the president, that was a former president at that time, how exactly it happened. Like, he deceived him. There was a banter at that time when they were pointing fingers on
that.
What
is rather
happened.
Strange.
Yes.
That is really rather strange for you to say the CBN governor didn't come out pop and plain to explain properly to the president.
Yes, the former
this is a policy the former
know.
President was in full support of. He made lots of live interviews, announcement regarding the policy, how he hoped it was going to help the economy and all that, and then someone is coming from their camp to say that. No, that's not true.
Did it really help the economy though, Aisha? From your perspective, did it really help? All it did, even though, yes, I would say some of us have become, you know, we've been trained to not actually carry cash around, you
right?
know? People are now used
cashless
to using the cashless policy thing, but people suffered. We have to emphasize on that.
Lots of businesses suffered.
Exactly.
Lots of businesses suffered. I was speaking with also a colleague who said he sold palm oil. So what he does is he buys cheaper at a certain period, season, and then sells for a higher price later. So during the Naira redesign policy, where we were asked to stop using the old 200 Naira, 500 Naira, 1,000 Naira notes, and then the cash became scarce, and then the new Naira notes came out. You know, then it was not easy accessing physical cash.
Indeed.
So if you had cash, you could get the product for the normal price.
Yes, yes.
But if you didn't have cash, you're going to have to pay extra. According to this colleague, he did say that he was supposed to buy the product, something he used to buy far less. He was supposed to buy, I think, with an extra 6,000 to 7,000 Naira. And then this is a business that he has to wait for a season to sell. So if he's buying it expensively this period, later in the year when he intends to sell,
how
is he going to sell it? Because there are other people whose products will be cheaper, and then he'll be running at a loss. So I think that was how that business died.
That is so sad. That means a lot of people lost their businesses. It's so sad, Aisha. And honestly, I feel like majority of Nigerians are in support of this probe. It's okay for us for the country to probe these people and check on accountability. Nobody would fault the president, even though in every situation we know that definitely there's some people that would have an opinion that is different. And it is okay. That's what makes us a nation. Everyone is entitled to their opinion. But I feel like it's a good thing for everyone. A really sad situation that we hope that everything is fixed. But anyways, we'll take a stop here on analyzing, you know, the newspaper. Do not go anywhere. When we come back, we're going to be opening the phone line for you to call in. And of course, we have something to talk to you about that we want also to hear from you. Don't go nowhere. We'll be right back.
Welcome back. Many thanks for staying with us. This is still Daybreak Extra on Trust Television. And now we're moving on to opening our phone line for discussion. And this morning we're moving away from politics because we've had all of that on our dailies. And I think we can't exhaust it. However, we'll have to discuss other topical issues. And today we're looking at, should parents decide their children's choice of spouse? I think that topic is something that is a bit dicey, but then it has to be talked about. Some decades back, arranged marriages was a common tradition in various societies. The groom and the bride are selected by the parents or relations rather than mutual choice between the parties involved. Today, things have changed drastically. Individuals find and select their own spouses without parents interfering. Tell us if you still feel parents should choose or select spouse and husbands for their children, and if you're in support of arranged marriage, what do you think about this? You can call us and drop a WhatsApp message via the phone numbers showing on your TV screen, and you can also call us, but as you call us, please do stay away from your mobile devices and your television so we can hear ourselves properly. The topic today, Sumaya.
A really interesting one, I must say. Parents, children.
I saw you smiling. I think you have something to say about it.
I do. You know, when you said these days people choose, and I'm like, well, we'll see where it got us, because some choose, and then yet the rate of divorce or, you know, sadness in marriage, abuses, it's too much. And you know, most times if we're having discussion about this modern marriage and
the traditional marriage,
there is difference, Aisha, whether we like it or not. Theirs was more lasting.
So if I'm hearing you correctly, you're in support of parents choosing spouses for their children.
That's what you're saying. I'm trying to weigh every situation. Okay. I'm not saying parents should force.
Okay.
Now, parents could direct.
Okay.
And it's okay.
Mm.
So a parent could see and be like, I like this person. Mm. No matter what, we all know that someone that is older tend to see some things differently. And it's up to you to be like, okay, let me try it out and see.
But however true that may be, I've also seen incidences where parents thought it best to choose a spouse, or direct now, to direct their children towards the right spouse, yeah? And then they got to know themselves, not as much, just briefly, a couple of months, and then, we already have a caller on the line. I guess we'll pick up this conversation again. Good morning, and where are you calling us from?
Hello, good morning. I'm calling from Yola, Adam Austin.
Can I get your name correctly?
Mohammed.
Okay, Mohammed from Yola, yeah? Go ahead, please.
Yes. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. Go ahead. Tell us what your take on arranged marriages.
Actually, the issue of parents not interfering in their children's choice of spouses does not even arise in our society. Because as guardians, as parents, we have the responsibility to make sure that our spouses have the right and the best choice in their life, and which is considered as a permanent one. So the issue is they have their own right to bring whoever they wishes, and we as parents also have the right to make them choose the best among all the candidates. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Mohammed, for that contribution. Mm. So
he's saying parents have the right and children also have the rights, but I think that's a bit more complicated if you ask me. Yes, parents have the rights and children have the rights, but I think it bodes well if children are allowed to. This is someone you intend to spend the rest of your life with, right? You should know better, don't you think so?
Do you really know better, though? Do you really know better? Well, the first thing we tend to see that is different from, say, okay, you bring a man and then your parent bring a man for you. The only difference, the first meeting would be chemistry. You saw that person and there is that chemistry.
Mm.
And this person, you already feel he's been imposing you. So there's a bit of, I'm doubting a bit. So I feel like that's the difference. Okay, we have another caller. Good morning.
Hello, good morning.
Yes, can you please speak louder so that we can hear you?
Good morning. My name is Usman Santaki from Yola.
Okay, Usman from Yola. Mm-hmm. Good morning. Thank you for joining us again.
Good morning, Sumaya, and the other guest, though. I don't know her.
Okay, so what's your take on the topic today?
Well, the topic is an interesting one.
Okay.
There's not anything wrong for parents to choose spouses for their children, as a male or female. But I feel ideally, they say the parents should give the children the latitude of getting their spouses on their own. I'm not disputing the fact that it is not wrong. Our parents, like my mother, it was her father that gave her in marriage to my father. And it lasted well until she died last year. So I don't think there's any argument for or against. It depends on the background of the family. In most societies now, you see some family, they even prefer that kind of marriages. They choose maybe a brother will give his daughter to the daughter of his younger brother, and the mother laughs. So I don't think it depends on how you perceive it, but ideally, if you see that there will be rancor, or at the end of the day, the mother will not last.
Okay.
It's advisable for the parents to give the latitude of choosing spouses for themselves. Thank you very much, Maya, and good day.
Thank you so much, Usman, for that contribution there. Okay, it's all about, you know, choices.
Mm-hmm.
Some believe that you should, you know, give the children the right to choose, and some say you should. Okay, so just because I'm saying parents should direct doesn't mean I'm saying impose. See, I get to choose, you know, I got to choose my own husband. I saw him, we understood each other to a point. And because I knew that I needed my parents' approval, I needed my parents to be in line with my decision, I told my dad that, okay, I want you to see him and talk to him. And if you're okay with him, then it's good. If you're not okay, then I'll step back. Because I knew that as a man to man, they tend to have an understanding. Mm-hmm. So I gave my father that platform to help me see through. We all know love can be blind. So I wanted him to see. So it's not like you're saying that the choice should be taken away from the person, but there should be that guidance. There should be someone to have like someone that has a tree sense different from your own emotions. Right. Yes, sir. Okay, so we have another caller there. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, what's your name and where are you calling from?
This is Mohammed from Zaria.
Okay, from Zaria. What's your name, please?
Mohammed.
Okay, Mohammed, thank you for joining us. What's your take on the topic today?
Yeah, this issue of choosing a spouse for children is something that is has to do with moral burden.
Okay.
As you see, parents are just a guardian to their children.
Go ahead.
Yes, they have a burden to choose for their children what they think is better for them. So I don't think parents would do something that will hurt or that will cheat their children. So children need to understand that their parents always think for better life for them. So, but sometimes parents have to think of their children and understand them so that they will do what is better for them.
Okay.
So I don't think it's something we discuss in public like that. It's something that parents have to and their children have to sit down and decide often. It's a burning issue within the family. Every family has such issues, especially nowadays that we have children that think they can decide for themselves. But it is not like that. That's my case.
Okay, but Mama, don't you think, though, parents sometimes, you know, are using selfish interests? It's based on, we know some parents that can look for a man because he's rich for their child or, you know, a woman, vice versa.
It's true like that, but sometimes you see our children, they don't understand that. They don't understand that. Sometimes your parent will choose something for you that you think is not good for you at your age now. Think of our parent. In house land now, you may not know your spouse until you enter your room or sometime in the past. But think of how long it will be, the marriage. But look at our nowadays marriage. Something, you marry a lady or you marry a man. Just 1 year, they will divorce. You see, but our parents, life something, if they learn something, it's our parents that will think of it. Because they have learned it since before we were born. That's what I think.
All right. Thank you so much, Mohammed, for that contribution.
Welcome. I think this topic is not a one-size-fits-all.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, as much as parents have this, they have this foresight, right? And then there's the moral value. And our society today, there's moral decadence, yes? But then again, I think I've seen a scenario where parents choose a spouse for, you know, the children or for the female child. And then it turned out that they didn't even get to know themselves. They just went straight to marriage because that's the ideal thing to do, right? And then they did. These people didn't spend up to 6 months together. And they were out of the marriage because they were strangers. Even as they were married, they were still strangers. You know, and this person had someone she was interested in before.
That hurts.
Then the parents felt, you know, I know this person, I know this person's family, let me just go ahead and let us just arrange this marriage for you. And then
okay, so we've started receiving messages. Okay, one says, parents should not pick who their children will marry, but they should keep an eye on them and advise them accordingly. Well, that's a very interesting contribution there. Please do not forget to always include your name and your location. That way you will know that, yeah, we appreciate you and we can relate. Okay, really interesting one there, Aisha. Yeah. He's saying parents shouldn't. So just
like I was saying earlier,
just like you were saying.
You know, they thought it best for their daughter. This person is from an ideal family. They are wealthy. You raised that point earlier. Mm. They can take care of you and everything. But by the end of the day, she got into the marriage and found out that this person is a mess. Apart from both of them being strangers, it turned out that they could not even relate at any level at all. They were almost always quarreling, and it was as if.
And that's the scary part.
And by
part.
The end of the day, they had to separate.
That's the scary part. Okay, good morning.
Hello?
Yeah, hello, we can hear you. Good morning. What's your name and where are you calling from?
I'm Umar calling from Barnet.
Okay, Umar from Barnet. Go ahead.
You're making a gift with yourself.
What? Can you please stay away from your TV set and talk to us?
Hello, Umar. Are you still there?
Okay, I think we lost the caller. Yes. So it's all about, you know, even though, say, parents of the difference of parents of before choosing for their children, actually, we have to pinpoint is that way back, the girls or the boys are not allowed to even date anyone. Mm. So by the time they just, you know, arrange a marriage with you with someone, he's someone new to you. So you have room to do. While these days, people are dating. Okay,
so
we have another caller.
We have another caller. Good morning. What's your name and where are you calling us from? Hello, good morning.
All right, we lost that caller again. Please keep trying, and if you can reach us, just call, send your message on WhatsApp so that we can, you know, get to read it out. Do not forget to always include your name and location. That way we'll get to read that out as well. Okay, so as I was saying, when parents, you know, are choosing way back, you don't really have a choice. You don't have anything to compare it with.
Right.
So because you've never dated, so you just date that one. But these days, people have room to date. So when you, a girl or a boy is already in love with someone, do not impose someone new
on
them.
I know, right? Yeah. So we do have another caller on the line. Good morning, and what's your name? Where are you calling us from?
Hello?
Good morning.
Good morning.
What's your name and where are you calling us from, please?
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. Please stay away from your TV set.
Okay, good morning.
Good morning. Your name and location, please. Yes, we can.
Yeah, I'm calling you from Jalingo, Tarapa State, Nigeria.
Okay.
What's your name, please?
The name is Bishop Dr. David Ocheje.
Okay. Nice. Thank you for joining us, Bishop. Go ahead with your contribution.
Hello?
Bishop, we can hear you. Go ahead, please.
Okay, the name is...
I think
please,
he needs to move away from
his TV
set.
Please move away from your TV set and talk to us. Please move away from your TV set. You don't need to hear yourself from your TV. You're already talking to us. So just talk directly. Reduce the volume of your TV set. Else the contribution that you're supposed to make would not be able to reach us. And at the end of the day, it's like you're wasting your time, you know, and losing an opportunity because a lot of calls or callers are trying to reach, you know, the line to talk about this situation. Okay, so right now we're going to read another message there.
Okay, so we have this message from Muslim Muhammad from Kaduna, where he says the idea is that individuals should have the freedom to make their own decisions based on their own preferences, values, and compatibility. What matters most is finding a balance between respecting cultural traditions, maintaining family harmony, and safeguarding the rights and autonomy of the individuals involved. It is crucial to promote open communication, mutual understanding, and empathy between parents and children in order to navigate this sensitive topic and reach a resolution that considers everyone's perspectives and well-being. That's a brilliant one from Muslim Muhammad from Kaduna.
Muslim Muhammad,
you know, I was reading that, and then
it.
I was, you know, trying to understand the message underneath, the meaning.
That's he tried to cover it everywhere. Mm. It says the couples should meet each other, talk, understand mm-hmm. each other.
Mutual
yes, and then the parent should be kind, you know, and have, when the child brings a person, then find a kind way, you know, to just, it's all about your child, right. Not about you. Okay, so we have another caller there. Good morning. All right, I think we lost that caller. Mm. Please keep trying to call us.
I think from Muslim Kaduna. Okay, there's another message on WhatsApp where this is Musa Umar from Gombe State. I want to say hi to you and may Allah reward you. I want to support this sent of children is most unfortunate. For example, I say I want to study electric engineering in high school and my parents did not support me. Okay, she wants me to study medicine. I know my talent is to be an engineer. Okay, that's a sad one.
Right? No, I think engineers are earning more money, though. When the contract's coming in, okay, so we have a first-hand someone saying, you know, leaving the parents to choose can hurt, you know, the child really bad.
I think this topic is all encompassing. It's not just about marriage now. It also boils down to career path, career choice.
Parents imposing their choice.
There are lots of parents, you know, growing up in secondary school, this is what you want to do, but then your parents are saying you should do something else. And by the end of the day, there's lots of unfulfilled dreams, unrealized ambitions and all that.
A really sad situation there. Oh, we hope that you figure it out, Omar. Okay, we have another message there from Aliyasa Ugarba from Maiduguri. He says, good morning, my sisters. Good morning. Parents should be the ones who make the marriage choices for their children. Though it is said that marriages are made in heaven, but we need to make a right choice to make it successful. Now, parents play a vital role in our lives, especially when it comes to big decisions like marriage.
Mm.
Okay, Aliyasa, a really good contribution. We'll talk about it. We have a caller now. Good morning.
Hello, good morning.
Yeah, what's your name and where are you calling from, please?
Yeah, my name is Bishop Dr. David Chidi, and I'm calling from Jalingo, Taraba State.
Okay. All right, Bishop, you called us back. So, what's your take?
I want to look at something that is very striking this morning on this, your conversation, especially looking at it from the dimension you had laid and other callers that have been coming in. I've been listening to the conversation.
Mm.
The marriage institution is a very sacred institution, irrespective of religion, ethnicity, and the diversity that is involved. I'm looking at it from this perspective. The two individuals that are coming together must come from the perspective of love. They have love for each other, and they should be given opportunity to express their love for each other. The suggestion and the interference of parents into the marriage institution most time can jeopardize the fulfillment of that union, because the parents are not going to live with these two individuals. Well, their opinions are good, their suggestions are good, their inputs are good, but these two individuals have to know themselves for themselves, and of course they have to understand themselves before they come together, and of course they have to believe in themselves, they have to have their own vision, they have to build their own union. They have to build their home.
Okay.
Bishop, okay.
Bishop from Jalingo. I think Bishop supports or buttresses my point earlier, the point I made earlier. I mean, these are the individuals that are going to stay in this institution forever, that however that may be. As much as the contribution of the parents are valid, and marriage is a sacred institution, and these people have been there, they spent years. As a matter of fact, they gave birth to you, so it is assumed they know better. It boils down to the two people who are still going to together. Be in that
and
marriage.
The parent might not really know. See, things about arranged marriage, when a parent starts showing their son to your daughter, they try to you know, paint him in the most beautiful light. Mm. Oh, he's an engineer. He's so, so and so. So they don't really point out his negative traits. Mm-hmm. And when the girl don't even get to like date him or get to know him.
It's as if the marriage is built on pretense. You
true.
Know?
And you don't know. You don't really. The girl, the people are doing it for the parents. So they don't really like each
it's
other.
It's like maybe a show. No chemistry. You know, we're just showing so that. Because our parents agree, so let us just act like that.
Even though Aisha, in some situations, we know that parents also can make the right choice. Like, you people could even have chemistry.
Mm.
But at the end of the day, you're not courting for long, mm-hmm. so you just marry. And you don't know how that person's anger management is. Mm-hmm. You don't know how that person reacts when really frustrated and mm-hmm. really sad. So there's a lot of things to cover. So I understand where Bishop is coming from. Okay, mm-hmm. so we have another message from WhatsApp.
So this person is Abubakar Kazim Ibrahim, and this message is from Joss, where he says, good morning. Girls should allow to choose their husbands. Parents advise them for the good person who has good character. Okay, I think this person is otherwise saying that girls should be allowed to choose their partners.
Yeah, we all know that the majority of the people that suffered a range of forced marriage are the ladies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, right. The boys get to choose at some point, or even if they tell them
to, society
they
is tend not to be rebellious. Fair to feminine gender, right? Society is not just
and the
fair.
Boys can easily be rebellious. Mm. We're not saying that some of them are not even forced into marriage. Mm-hmm. They are, but then some of them can rebel, like, I am not going to.
Right.
And the parents.
But women
listen.
Are not given as much chance as the exactly. men are, because exactly. as a lady, you're not even allowed to be rebellious to your
true,
parents.
True.
You're supposed
I have
to
a
just...
story. Okay, we have a caller there. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, what's your name?
Away I'm just carried away by your topic, and I want to contribute.
Okay, go ahead.
Hello? Okay, I'm James from Court of Appeal, Pastor James from Kaduna.
Your name?
Pastor James
okay,
from Kaduna.
Okay, we have a pastor. Okay, pastor from Kaduna. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Okay. I really appreciate your contribution. And the issue of decision for children that are mature enough to have their spouse.
Mm.
It is not allowed biblically. And even Islamically, it's not allowed as well. Every child that is grown up, because marriage is for women and men, it's not for the babies. So those ones that have already decided and matured enough from the age of 20 to 30, they have to decide on their own to marry. Because you are not going to, just like the bishop said, you are not going to stay with them. They say, father, leave his mother or parents and go. Or the husband leaves his parents and go and cling to his wife. So it is an issue that two of them have to decide. There are three stages of marriage. Approach, from approach to courtship, from courtship to the marriage proper. They should know the do and don't of each other. And if you compel them to marry each other without knowing their do and don't, it creates a lot of problems. Misconception, misappropriation, and the marriage might not last. So it is better to allow them.
Hmm.
Both the children can equally come and tell you the parents, this is the person I love. I want to marry him. I want to marry her. You say, are you sure? Yes. Then let them observe themselves in these three stages. Approach, the courtship before the marriage proper. And they observe themselves, particularly when that courtship is the do and talk and not of both the young man and the young woman. He can decide, no, I'm not fitting to this man's character. I'm not fitting to this woman's character. I will not marry her. Within that question, approach doesn't matter, but it matters a lot. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
They approach can be. Maybe you see him or her physically. Maybe he's very brilliant in the school, a schoolmate, or you see her very beautiful, elegant, the structurally, but in the inside, the characters are not much. So when during the courtship, they can equally say, I see her, I see him, he's very handsome, he's very beautiful, but the character is not matched to my own. They can't marry.
Okay,
so
thank you.
You the parents, now you can equally counsel them. Because after the counseling, in the process of to marry, after they have married themselves, you don't have part of love. You need to advise them. And when you advise them, they take it or not, it's left for you. But you to say, I will not grieve my son. He must marry this person. I will not grieve. It's my daughter. She must marry this person. It's very wrong of any parent or any rule to just go on that.
All right. Thank you so much, Pastor James, for that wonderful contribution. Actually, this reminds me of a story of a father, you know, forcing his two children to get married to, and both daughters were dating some different men, and they got married. One was patient to tolerate the new husband, and the other tried, but she said she couldn't fall in love with them. And at the end of the day, she ended up killing herself. A really sad and scary situation. And this happened in the north. So parents definitely forcing thing, it's a no-no. You can only direct if
you can,
you
only
perhaps
guide.
Know,
you can only advise.
Exactly, advise.
I think we're in a modern society now where we have enlightened people. As much as that is, I know the divorce rate has gone up too, but then I still think the two people who intend to be married, who intend to stay in this institution for as long as they want to, they should be given the opportunity to see for themselves, choose. Parents should just
that
serve
is one
as
of
a
the
guide.
Big decision that a person should do for themselves. You know, even as a parent, you feel, I want you to have the best, but leave that person to make
that is you even believing themselves. Your children are matured enough.
Indeed.
You know.
Okay, so we have more messages. Let's take one. Says, this is from Aisha from Yobe. Parents can sometimes be sentimental and decide the wrong person for you. Not all parents are right, and not all of them have, you know, reason well. Which is true. You know, at the beginning of this,
you mentioned something like this earlier.
Like sometimes, not everyone is blessed to have the best parent. There's some that they love their child, but they love money more.
There's some sense of sentiment that comes into it.
Exactly. So at the point that you're supposed to pick, you know, for your child, it's all about maybe the family name. And say maybe this person is from this family, but then he drinks a lot, he does something, you know, negative traits that he has. And yet the parent know, but it's all about...
Sometimes the parents are aware of the traits, the terrible traits of the other person that they intend for their children. But then they just neglect it and say, you know,
you'll be happy, you'll be contented. So situations like that. So yes, Aisha, we can, of course, relate with what you're saying. Thank you for that message. A really sad one. There's a deep conversation, Aisha, on this. And as much as we know that parents are sometimes, you know, they have the foresight, but still. Okay, so we have another caller there. Good morning. Oh, sorry. So we're taking a message. I think we lost that call there. It says, the topic is an interesting one. My contribution is that parents should recommend who their children can marry, but not forcing them. However, the choice of the children must have the blessings of their parents. This message is from Ibrahim from Maiduguri. Well, thank you, Ibrahim, there. So we have another caller. Good morning.
Hello.
Yeah, good morning. What's your name and your location?
Hello?
Yeah, please stay away from your TV set. Reduce the volume of your TV set.
Good morning.
Okay, what's your name and where are you calling from? Again, your name and your location?
Is it not the number? Sorry, I'm watching the first television this morning.
Yeah.
But the answer, I think, is not the people that doing the program that are telling me.
That's because you're looking at your television. You are listening to the volume from there. But right now, you can talk to us.
Okay. Concerning the topic.
Yeah.
The marriage topic,
Yes, yes. Go ahead.
Okay. Okay. So the topic they are being discussed, you know, is really concerning me.
Okay.
Because even now, right now, I have issues in my marriage.
Oh. Yeah,
whereby my mother-in-law, every just 24 hours in a day, I can count the highest. He was disgraced every time in communicating with my wife. You know, it's just like he lived on his husband's house and also living also in my house.
Mm.
But their communication is all about me. What they can do to me, you know. So I wonder. It was, you know, and even now, we are not together anymore.
Mm.
And truly, whereby a wife that you marry has no love in you, always saying that your parents just give you up because of your money or because of this. You know, you are not even interested to see whether, you know, my health issue, all it needs is just for me, you know, I'm spending for you, you don't care for me, even to show love. You even show love to the boys that are living with me, than I, as a husband. I just listen. I'm also always, you know, when I was into this marriage, the only thing they say, I'll take it the day I will give up. You know, before the woman John left me and go back to the parents. So, now, you know?
Yes.
So now, I don't know. And he has a baby for me. Although I do pay her, you know, some money, you know, to take care of the baby. But
okay.
The issue of two of us getting married, it cannot work because the marriage that you know that maybe it can be maybe something that one day a person can kill each other. It's not a marriage.
Okay, when thank you.
Something
thank you very much.
In a way of threatening of life. So mm-hmm. I want to know what the advice you can give as far in such marriage.
Okay.
You know, thank you very much.
That is a sad one right there. I'm sure everyone is watching and then they'll have one or two advice to chip
we
in.
We hope you figure it out. A really sad one there. Parents should try not
to. We keep talking about meddling.
Meddle. Yes, that's the word.
We have another caller on the line. Good morning. Can you tell us your name and where you're calling us from? Okay, we lost that call. And let's go back to our WhatsApp platform where we have a message from Abdulrazak Maigari, Abuja FCT. He says, parents should be the one to recommend, but that of choosing should be the prerogative choice of the children. Freedom at last.
Okay. Indeed, that's
I think everyone has been saying recommendation should be from parents, but choosing, that choice.
The choice
should lie solely on the children.
We shouldn't take away that choice.
A parent could recommend, you know, okay, I think this person is a good fit for you. Mm. However, the choice is solely yours.
Because it's something forever. It's not like you're saying, no, Aisha, don't take that daily trust newspaper. Do something else, you know, or what to eat. This is a lifetime decision. So you need to let the children make that decision.
Right.
All you can do is just advise them. The meddling can hurt marriage, please. Okay, we have a message from Dahiru Usman from Yola. He says, they say it doesn't matter whether you pick your spouse or it's picked for you, right?
Mm.
Because you will never find a complete perfect partner. That's true. As we would wish for ourselves. But it's easy to reconcile with the partner you pick than the ones that was picked for you. I think for ladies at a younger age, parents should decide for them. But isn't that,
I think this is contradicting himself. You're already saying that the choice should be for the partners.
And then you came back to say for younger girls, not the boys.
I think
there's a disconnect. Right now, you're hurting the ladies.
So what is he saying? That so if you're at a younger age, and as a lady, the parents should choose. But then when you become older, what happens to the younger boys?
Exactly. They get to choose even Dahiru, a really a funny contribution there, even though you made your point. From the beginning, I agree with you. Parent cannot force someone. You can only,
recommend
guide, support. Right.
Advice.
Yes. But anything other than, you know, forcing. If you feel like your girl child that is underage or is not ripe for that kind of decision.
Is not matured enough.
Then allow her
to get matured.
Okay, so we have another caller there. Mm. Good morning.
Yeah, hello.
Yes. What's your name and your location, please?
Yes, I need to get back online with you. This is still Bishop Dr. David.
Okay.
The reason why I call back is just to follow up with the last caller.
Okay.
The last caller has really dropped a very mind-blowing information.
Yeah, go
ahead. Okay, continue.
The last caller has really made a very striking point. He's talking about the interference of the mother-in-law into the marriage, and they kept talking, and his life is under threat. And I also want to make an observation that this is a very interesting platform. This, your interaction is very important, that maybe in subsequent, I'm only making an observation and a suggestion to contribute to this important platform, that maybe you can also involve some from the clerics of both authority to be able to be part of this platform, so that such striking questions can be given attention to, because it's one of the appalling issues in the society, and a lot of marriages are affected in this manner. And of course, I want you to please give attention to that question, and so that that man can be attended to, because it's really, really not him alone, but a lot of institutions are affected in that manner. When you have the parents intruding into the matrimony, when the attention of the spouse has been taken from the man or the lady, his mother is taking his attention, or the father is taking his attention from his partner, it can be very, very boring, and it can make the home a hostile place for the partner. So we really need to pray for that young man, so that he cannot make the second mistake. And he needs really somebody who is really an authority in the faith to be able to counsel him, and then be able to guide him through, so that he will not miss out in life.
All right. Thank you, Bishop, for coming back to give, you know, priority to that particular caller. Really good observation there. And of course, sometimes we tend to bring, you know, a psychologist, someone, a marriage counselor to discuss these certain issues. And perhaps we might look into it. We might bring someone.
I was going
next
to
week.
Say that this program is a platform that allows for almost everyone and every authorities coming to speak to matters and issues. There are psychologists and who have come on the program to talk about certain issues. And for that particular caller who's suffering this or has suffered or has gone through this and felt the need to share, I appreciate you sharing that story. And
just stay tuned to Trust TVC next week, and we'll try to bring someone, you know, to discuss about certain issues for people that suffer issues like this, because this situation, it's not all about a man doing, you know, facing this. Even women face the in-law issues and all that, and it's not good. Okay, I think we have another caller there. Good morning.
Morning.
Yeah, your name and your location, please.
Yes, my name is Ahmed Jibrin Jain, from Lafia, Nasarawa State.
Okay, thank you for joining us, Ahmed.
Yes, I really enjoyed this, your program, Daybreak. Specifically, this topic, should parents decide their children's choice of spouse? Yes, of course. It is very, very salient at this crucial time, because of the experiences that we are seeing today. Because of naivety, because of love, you know, spouse is met in the schools, in the cafe, in different places, without fully knowing, understand the background of each other, we just engage into a marital relationship. At the end of the day, the relationship will not hold. So many things. Instead of them to, you know, remain a loving partner, they will, at the end of the day, becoming a enemy. Therefore, to my view, it is very, very important for parents to keep in, you know, in selecting, in choosing whose partner should be. Because what they can see behind, the couple may not see, they will not be able to see. So there is nothing wrong. There is nothing wrong for parents to, you know, intervene in selecting who becomes their husband or their son's wife at this time. Yeah, in cases, they can choose for themselves. But in most cases, you know, their role, parental role in this thing is very crucial. So we cannot negate or throw away our value system. We can, we have to hold it. You know, Western culture, you know, we can't always, we need to look inward to our value system. So, you know, I'm an Hausa man from the northern part of the country. You know, when you look at the, for example, Fulani cultures, you know, they play their role and it works for them. It works for them. You understand? So at this
Even though it works for some it doesn't work. And if we should look at it, you know, Islamically, it's not said that the parents should force. So we're talking about the forcing. You can arrange marriage. There are some situations where you see the children will be the one to tell the parents, you know what, choose someone for me. And that's also called arranged marriage.
Mm-hmm.
So what's your take on that? Do you think the parents are forced because you use the word key in? Should they actually have to choose or should force. They just guide? Yeah, should they force or just guide the children? Okay, I think we lost Ahmed there. Mm. And right now we'll read some few messages from WhatsApp.
Well, we have, this is Doji from Bauchi State. He says, marriage is like an investment. It factors children's input. The most important part of children's choice is the understanding between the intending couples. Most marriages don't last long because the parents impose on their children based on their interests. Of course, there are marriages that were ruined by responsible parents and work perfectly, but understanding between the children is key because marriage is beyond love. It descends to other factors such as respect, time management, and caring.
And if there is no respect, then there's a problem, which is true. Comrade there made a good point. Yes,
Bauchi State. Yeah, he did make a good point.
Okay, we have a lot of messages here. That we would read. And okay, right now I think we have a lot that we need to go through. And honestly, I feel like some people, we can't really get their message. Okay, so we'll read this one. It says, good morning, sisters. Good morning. I'm Rukaya Ibrahim from Kogi State. Thank you, Rukaya. Most parents' decisions are the best. Mostly girls don't know what they want, but things mostly go well with the parents' advice and decisions.
Mm.
Okay, Hussein, I'm sure some Rukaya, right? I'm sure some people might disagree with you when you say most girls don't know what they want. All right, that's all we can take today on, you know, the messages and the phone call on marriages. Should it be arranged or not? Thank you so much for calling in, for sending messages, for those that we could not read.
I think this topic, we may have to bring it back again. Like I said, I said it's a dicey one.
Mm.
It's really a dicey one. It's something we cannot exhaust.
Exactly, and it needs to, you know, be a tackle. Anyways, thank you so much for staying with us. Do not go anywhere. When we come back, the show continue. Stay with us.
on your dream. I don't care if you don't have the money, you don't have the help, and you don't have the family for it. Don't you give up on your dream. Don't you do it. Don't you do it. Don't you do it. It may take you twice as long. You may have to take courses and classes. You might not have as much, but don't you quit.
Okay, that was a hard one, and I was watching it. I'm like, can I survive that, Joe? Even though he made it seem so easy. So right now we'll be talking about the essence of keeping fit. Now, maintaining a good level of physical fitness is really important. However, it can be difficult to determine what fitness, you know, entails. Various components of physical health can help determine physical fitness. And now exercising increases cardiorespiratory endurance in a number of ways. For example, the heart muscle becomes stronger so that it's, you know, able to pump more blood per heartbeat. And at the same time, additionally, small arteries grow within muscle tissue so that they can deliver blood to working muscles more effectively when needed. And maybe that's why when you haven't, you know, exercised for a while, you feel stiff. Any small movement, you have this muscle pull and all that. But anyways, we have an expert, a personal trainer, joining us in the studio today by the name Edwin August. He is a fitness content creator, a personal trainer, model, and an actor. Good morning. So thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.
So Edwin, tell us about, you know, I want you to explain first what's happening in that video, because there was a lot of, you know, cardio, a lot of jumping and flipping, mm-hmm. and a dumbbell movement, and there was a hammer that got me confused at some point. I'm like, what's happening there? But things like this tend to discourage some people. They feel like, do I have the energy to go exactly. all out like this?
Exactly.
Walk us through it.
All right, so what you just saw mm-hmm. was the content creating part
okay.
of the fitness. All right, the okay. fitness dives into other things than just that, right?
Okay.
First of all, most when people hear fitness, the first thing that comes to mind is lifting weight and nah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right, fitness first is about healthy living.
Okay.
Your lifestyle. Right, so like what you said, it helps with your heart, your lungs, and every other thing, even the muscles as well. So you usually don't have to lift too many weights to stay fit.
Okay.
All right, cardiovascular exercises, strength training. For example, I major in strength training, right? That's what you saw.
Okay.
So strength training involves functional movement, and I have to lift from time to time, right? This helps in the long run, not just now, for any other person. So yes, you should engage more in strength training as well as a person in your fit training. But then, it's not about everything you just said there. Right? It's just
okay, so let's dive in. What is fitness all about? What does it entail?
So first for me, I tell people that fitness is more mental than it's physical.
Okay, right? Do tell.
So, for example, it's some people find the gym as a safe haven.
Okay.
Right? It's the one place where you can come and let everything out without being judged.
Okay.
Basically, right? For example, you are one that probably you're in the office every time. You don't have much friends. You can build a social life from the gym.
Okay.
Right? So it's not just about the workout now. It's about your mental alertness and emotional stability as well.
Mm.
So fitness goes beyond just lifting weights.
Mm.
Okay?
Mm.
So a lot of, personally for me, I found most of my friends I got them from the gym because I'm not always active outside. If it's not work, I'm in the gym. So most of my cliques are from the gym. Why? Because from Alpha, can I have this dumbbell? It becomes, hey, I like your hair.
Mm.
Because I like your shoe. From there, you guys start seeing similarities. You have a friend from there.
Mm.
So now you have a reason to want to go back to the gym.
Mm. I think I can actually relate with you when you talk about mental alertness for fitness. Yeah, I remember back in, was it 2020? I had just lost a friend and it was a lot for me. I was going through all of that and I just felt the need to, you know, why not just hit the gym? And I was channeling all of that energy into whatever it is, whatever activity I was doing in there. And I saw that I was getting better. I could think better. I could process my emotions better.
Yes.
And I had people to talk to, even if we're not necessarily talking about what I was going through. But then I was
just you could share. Yeah, you could just say something. It helped boost your mood as well. Trust me, it does.
Yeah, also.
But then what do you think should drive your fitness goal?
First of all, your health.
Okay.
Right? Like I said, in the long run, it's not just about the now. So when most people just do fitness probably to look good, or they only remember when it's summer, is when they invite the girls to the gym.
Summer body.
No, it's good for we fitness guys because, I mean, they will tend to make money in that period.
I know,
but,
right?
Then, but then, it shouldn't just be about the summer.
Mm.
What happens after summer?
Mm.
Right? So it's not like you're going to stop eating. So you stop eating some things from now, then after summer, you go back to eating those things. So basically, fitness is just, how will I put it now? What's that word? I'm trying to find the word. It's life,
okay.
Basically. Mm. It's life because growing up, you find it helps try for aging people. It helps you from falling down because then you get
keep going.
So, but if you're active from before, it helps you in this time because now you've done strength training, your bones can withstand some things, you don't get to trip over little things, you know. Picking up things, as much as picking up plates or buckets from your toilet, trust me, it goes as far as that. So when you see people doing deadlifts, it involves that as well. So you have to get the right form. So, I mean, in the long run, it's not just for now.
You talked about strength fitness or strength training.
Strength training.
Apart from strength, what other trainings are there?
Well, I mean, we have the aerobics training, we have CrossFit training, which is really, really big. I mean, to be a big thing here in Nigeria.
What's that?
CrossFit.
Okay.
So it's a bit of everything.
Oh, okay.
Weightlifting, cardio, aerobics, strength training, everything basically, mobility. So it's good. It's one of the fastest growing exercises in the world right now. That's CrossFit because it, like I said, it's a functional movement. So every part of your body down to your mind, your neck, your eyes, everything is working at that point in time. So yeah, that's that.
Whatever type of fitness goal or fitness training one has in mind, I like to know the role of one's health before embarking on a fitness goal. Well, I'm asking this question because I remember one of my episodes during my health program where I interviewed someone regarding this same fitness.
Okay.
And then the lady did say that she loved to do all of that aerobics, you know, the dumbbell, everything. She was doing literally everything. But she found out that it was affecting her heartbeat. Yes, it was taking a toll on her heartbeat. Meanwhile, she had a condition earlier before she went into that. So I want to know, how prepared should one be physically, health-wise, before, should it inform the kind of fitness goal of type?
So when a client comes to me first, I ask a few questions. First of all, any health issues? Right? You let me know. Any injuries anywhere, you let me know. Because this determines the kind of workout I give to you. So most trainers always want a perfect point. Right? Because it's all about, you know, that vigorous exercising, you're dropping up and down. It's not all about that sometimes. You can end up doing something really small for 10 minutes and you burn as much calories as what you do for 1 hour.
Mm.
It depends on the angle of which you come from. Now, I've had clients that had asthma, right? But when you started working out, which naturally, when you do something that's too much, too intense for your heart, you tend to like have that issue with breathing.
Right.
But now, when going into the fitness world, doing what you've been doing for a while now, they don't even use that all the time anymore. Because now you tend to learn how to control your breathing even while exercising. Because that's also very, very important when lifting as well. How you breathe, what you breathe, and all of those things. So now she's better in that aspect. So now you also have to know, as a trainer, have to know what your client is going through, their health issues, and know the kind of exercise to give to them. The time you might be training a client and their heart rate goes really, really high.
Okay.
You have to slow them down at that
but
point.
But I thought the heartbeat is part of the whole cardio thing.
It's not for
us to die. When your heartbeat rate is faster, you know that you're doing cardio right. I think I read that somewhere.
It doesn't have to be like that.
Okay, so there has to be a balance.
There has to be a balance. You know, as much as people don't go more believe it, but even weightlifting, it's cardio.
Okay.
Because your heartbeat is there.
That's true.
You can, so it doesn't have necessarily have to be about just jumping and jumping. You can be just between a regular squat, this cardio.
Okay. I know it's not all about physical exercise. There's always a place of dieting and nutrition. Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, and let me add to that. Considering, you know, Aisha mentioned her situation of, you know, when you're depressed, you're sad, you wake up and exercise, that would help. But other people tend to fall to food. And the food they get adjuncts to fill up, you know.
It makes them obese and all
exactly.
that. So what's the place of food, you know, dieting, nutrition in fitness?
Okay, so just like I said earlier, it's as important as your fitness.
Okay.
In fact, maybe more important. Because no matter what you do in the gym, you need the right nutrition to balance off of that.
Okay.
Because you've lost some things in the gym. Right? So, in terms of that now, for example, you want to lose weight. So, losing weight, you definitely know you have to go on calorie deficit.
Okay.
Most of us don't know how much our body needs to eat in a day, like how much calories need to eat in a day. Probably you might need to eat about 3,000 calories in a day. And most times we don't even eat up to that because we don't even measure what we eat, basically. So now, if you're not eating up to what your body should eat in a day, that's a deficit. So if you're trying to burn down or lose fat, that's good. So you should go on calorie deficit, right? But when you're trying to gain muscles or anything, you go on a surplus where you have to eat times.
So, I see.
In a case where you want to lose weight, but now you don't exercise or you exercise just minimally, and you tend to eat about 3,000 calories in that day. Mind you, the amount of work you have to put in to burn 700 calories is a lot. You might just think it's a whole lot. You might be in the gym for 1 hour, 30 minutes, and you're still not burnt enough calories as to what you've had. So you have to eat the right things, the right nutrients, to balance out what you did in the gym, or else it's just going to fall back to a lot of things.
So, as a fitness guru, you know, a Nigerian food can really not really help in terms of the whole dieting thing. And if you decide to invest in dieting, it can be quite taxing. It's exhausting. It shakes you financially. So it's like it favors the rich more. So for a normal and average Nigerian, how can they survive? You know, with the things that with the little money that they have.
Okay. Discipline is how you survive, right? Portion what you eat, basically. Of course, we know it's only rice we have to eat. So that does not mean we should eat a whole bowl of rice.
I know, right?
Okay? Because you have a little spaghetti at home, doesn't mean you should eat only spaghetti, like a full spag.
Okay.
Right? So discipline is what, that's the only thing. Even the rich as well. You know, do you know how tasking it is to come out from work and having to go to the kitchen to go and blend some veggies?
Indeed.
I know.
So it all boils down to discipline at the end of the day. How disciplined are you? How bad do you want it?
Okay, discipline. I'll put that in mind. Okay, Edwin, tell us how long. You mentioned that it can be really taxing, you know, if you want to burn 700 calories. So let's say Aisha and I walk into your gym. And we want that summer body by summer.
I mean, it's
how
doable.
How much energy, how much time are we talking about? Days, week, months? How long can one, you know, exercise? And what's the right exercise for a particular period of time?
Maximum. In 90 minutes, you should be able to get as much done as you can.
Don't you give up on your dream. I don't care if you don't have the money. You don't have the help. And you don't have the family for it.
Don't you give up on your dream. Don't you do it. Don't you do it. Don't you do it. It may take you twice as long. You may have to take courses and classes. You might not have as much, but don't you quit.
Okay, so for you, I would say just engage in my
functional.
So strength training and functional movement.
Just keep going that way.
That's just it.
Okay, so what?
Don't you give up on your dream.
It's a lifestyle.
I don't care
lifestyle.
If you don't have the money.
Going that way.
You don't have the help. And you don't have the family for it. Don't you give up on your dream. Don't you do it. Don't you do it. Don't you do it. It may take you twice as long. You may have to take courses and classes. You might not have as much, but don't you quit.
Then, you should be honest. So most times people will just wait for you. Right? At some point they tend to shred. Okay, so at that initial, and again, our metabolism acts differently as well.
Right.
Okay, what you would do that you might lose weight or lose some amount of calories might not work for her. She might do that and gain muscles.
Okay.
Because it works differently. Mm. But now, it gets to a point where you hit a plateau and your body starts understanding, okay, this is what we are doing.
Okay.
This is what we are doing this for. Then you start seeing the result. Also goes back to your nutrients as well. What do you eat after your workout?
So this situation, it comes back to you. That's why people should have a personal trainer to help guide.
That's what I tell people. That's what I tell people.
Okay, so I have this particular question about the role of exercising and fitness in aging.
Yeah.
You know, we've seen Nollywood actor Kate Henshaw. She's over 50. And amongst others, you know, there's Jennifer Lopez, that's Hollywood though, other people in the industry, even people outside of the industry, who seem to be aging backwards. They call themselves vampires. Yeah. They seem to be aging backwards. Mm-hmm. And then they would say this thanks to exercise and keeping fit. I'd like for you to tell the people who are out there watching, some people, they see these people putting in the work, but then there's this part of them, they're like, ah, no, do you think I should really work for me? But as a guru, I'd like for you to shed more light on that.
Okay, so first of all, when you sweat out some things, you open up pulses. Right? If you notice after you work out in the gym, go to get a picture on the mirror, you see how fresh you look. Because you've opened up pulses, right? So that's one thing fitness does to you. It helps prevent diseases, right? Cardiovascular diseases as well, right? Even viral illnesses around you. Little things as the air you take into your skin can affect how you look. So when you sweat these things out, like sweat out all those things, it's good. So this is one of the biggest parts of fitness, how it makes you look.
Okay.
Right? Because you tend to look so young, and when they ask you your age, you're like, whoa, how do you do that? Because you are active enough, your bones are in line with your mind. It also goes down to here too. So imagine if you're 40 and you lift like 100 kg, you feel young, like, yeah. You know, it goes down to this as well. How do you feel in here?
So what are your final words to people who intend to pick up physical fitness as something to do moving forward? A lifestyle.
Just show up. Hit the next gym close to you and just keep showing up.
What about if you want to
There's no secrets.
What about
you can't do it at home. Yeah, I've had people that have had like good results from the house. From the house, it's all discipline. Can you keep up with doing 500 skips every day? There are days you wake up like, oh, maybe I will do that tomorrow. You know, and once you give yourself that first excuse not to do it that day, you give yourself another excuse not to do it tomorrow.
I can relate to that. All right, Edwin Augusta, thank you so much for joining us. Personal trainer, fitness, content creator, model, and an actor. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge today with us.
Thank you for having me, guys.
All right, and now we wrap up at Daybreak Extra on Trust the TV. Do not forget to follow us across all our social media platforms and get to catch up, you know, on everything that we bring to you. Also, make sure you stay tuned for our Daybreak me, Adji Shafe, who will be bringing you sport. I am Sumaya Abubakar.
And I'm Aisha Salihu. See you again next Saturday.